Hello dear friends, today's topic is talus fracture. So to start with, talus is a part of tarsal bones. Tarsal bones are present in foot. There are seven tarsal bones. The upper row consists of talus, below it the calcaneus, then we have the navicular, then three cuboids and one cuneiform. Okay, so this is your talus, this is your calcaneus, this is your navicular. It is called navicular because it is boat shaped. It is similar in shape to scaphoid bone. Scaphoid bone, if you remember, was also a boat shaped bone. Then we have the three cuneiforms. This and the lateralmost we have the cuboid. So the today's topic is on talus bone. So talus is this part which is shaded in yellow. Then coming to the anatomy of the talus bone. So talus bone consists of five parts. Five parts are head, neck, body, and there are two processes. Processes are lateral process and the posterior process. So this is your head, this is your neck, and this is your body. This part is your posterior process and this part is your lateral process. So there are in total five parts: head, neck, body, and two processes that are posterior and the lateral process. Then coming to the body of talus. So the body of the talus consists of five surfaces. So they are superior, inferior, medial, lateral, and posterior. Okay, there is no anterior surface because anterior surface is covered by the neck. So there are in total five free surfaces, which are superior, inferior, medial, lateral, and posterior. So each surface is articulating with a important structure. So the lateral surface, it articulates with the lateral malleolus. The medial surface, it articulates with the medial malleolus. The superior surface, it articulates with the trochlear surface or the tibia. The inferior surface or the under surface, it articulates with the calcaneus. It has articular facets which articulates with the calcaneus. And the posterior surface, it is not covered by any bone, but it has two important, the posterior tubercle. Okay, so the posterior tubercle consists of posterior lateral and posterior medial part, which is a part of the posterior surface. Then continuing the anatomy. So as we already discussed, it articulates with some of the important bones. It articulates with tibia, fibula, calcaneus, and the navicular. You can see here talus. This part is your talus. So it articulates with the tibia here. It articulates with the calcaneum here. It articulates with the fibula here. And it articulates with the navicular, this part here. Then tarsal is the second largest tarsal bone. The largest tarsal bone is calcaneus. After calcaneus, talus is the largest part of the largest bone of the tarsal bones. 60% is covered by the articular cartilage. If you remember, while we were studying scaphoid was covered 70% with the articular surface. So talus is covered 60% with the articular cartilage. And one most peculiar point about talus is there are no muscle attachments. Talus has zero muscle attachment. It gives attachment to ligaments, but it gives no attachment to muscles. Then there are ligaments. We had studied some of these ligaments or touched upon them in the ankle fracture lecture. So on the medial side, It has the deltoid ligament. So deltoid, it consists of two parts of the deltoid ligament: anterior tibiotalar ligament, posterior tibiotalar ligament. This is your tibia, this is your talus. So sorry, this is your calcaneum, this is your talus. So it has two ligaments. Those are the anterior tibiotalar, this one, and the posterior tibiotalar, this one. These two ligaments on the medial side. On the lateral side, it has the it consists of part of the lateral collateral ligament. The part which is present is anterior talofibular ligament. So this is your talus, and this is your fibula. So this is your anterior talofibular ligament, which is present on the lateral part. On the posterior part also, it consists of part of lateral collateral ligament, which is the posterior talofibular ligament. So this is your tibia, and this is your talus, this part. So this is your posterior talofibular ligament. Then coming to the blood supply of the talus. Talus is supplied by three blood vessels. Those are the anterior tibial artery, posterior tibial artery, and the perforating peroneal artery. The most important blood supply is the posterior tibial artery. If asked in detail, posterior tibial artery gives a branch known as artery of tarsal sinus, or the tarsal canal, this part. So the posterior tibial artery, it gives a branch known as the artery of tarsal canal, which is the most important blood supply of the talus bone. Anterior tibial artery sometimes gives a direct branch, or sometimes it gives a branch through the dorsalis pedis artery. So it can either be anterior tibial artery or a dorsalis pedis artery. So this is your anterior tibial artery. It gives a branch, dorsalis pedis artery, which combines with the branch of perforating peroneal artery, forming the artery of tarsal sinus. This is the artery of tarsal sinus, and the posterior tibial artery was giving a branch of artery of tarsal canal. So artery of tarsal canal, which is a branch of posterior tibial artery, is the main blood supply. Then coming to the proper topic, that is the talus fractures. Coming to the incidence, it is a rare fracture. It consists of 5 to 7% of all the foot fractures. So it's not so common. There are few mechanisms of injuries. The most common mechanism is a directly applied force in the dorsal direction. So dorsal directed force applied to plantar surface of foot in dorsiflexion. That is the most common mode of injury. So we can see the foot is in dorsiflexion here, and there is a dorsally directed force applied to the lower surface or this or plantar surface. So this leads to most common talus injury. This is your talus separated in two parts. Then it can be a supination injury. Supination will be rotational injury. Then we can have an axial loading like this. The patient will give a history of fall from a height, or it can be a compression force. Then coming to clinical features, like most of the fractures in orthopedics, the clinical features are mostly common. There will be history of trauma, there will be intense pain, there will be inability to bear weight on the injured foot. There will be deformity present at the ankle, there will be swelling, there will be ecchymosis. Ecchymosis is this reddish or blackish or bluish discoloration of the foot. This is due to collection of blood. And there can be a subluxation or dislocation of the ankle because of a fracture of the talus. Then coming to the investigations will again be the same. It will consist of x-rays and CT scans. X-rays will have the anterior, posterior, and the lateral view, which are common to most of the fractures. Then we have the ankle mortise view. Ankle mortise view, we have discussed in ankle fractures. That is anterior posterior view of ankle in 15 degrees of internal rotation. Why we do 15 degrees of internal rotation? Because normally the fibula is present 15 degree posterior to the tibia. So to bring them parallel, we do an internal rotation view so that the tibia and the fibula comes in a same plane and we can see this ankle mortise properly. Then we have a special view here known as a canal view. So this is your canal view. In canal view, we internally rotate or we pronate the foot of the patient to 15 degrees here. We internally rotate it 15 degrees. Then we keep the foot in maximum plantar flexion, this direction. Okay. And then we, this is your X-ray machine. So the beam from the X-ray machine will come like this, 75 degree to the horizontal surface. This is your horizontal surface. And this is your angle of 75 degrees. So the angle of the X-ray beam is directed 75% from the horizontal. And this view is used for two proper points. First is it gives a best view of the talus neck. And it also helps to determine varus or valgus deformity of the talus bone. So this helps in your reduction in your operation theater while you can see the talus bone on the C-arm. Then we can also do a CT scan. If you have a doubt regarding the articular surface or the injury to the articular surface of the talus and the tibia. Okay, so this is your talus articular surface. Or if you are dealing with a comminuted fracture, then you can order a CT scan. So you can see all the fragments properly and plan your treatment. Like we can see here, there's a small fragment present in the CT scan, which is not always visible on the X-ray. So we can plan the treatment better. And coming to the classification, there are two classifications. First is the anatomical classification and second is the Hawkins classification. So anatomic classification will be very most easy. That is, the fracture will occur through the anatomical part. So it can be a talar neck fracture, it can be a talar body fracture, talar head fracture. It can be a fracture of the medial facet, medial process, or it can be a fracture of the posterior process. So according to anatomical site, we can classify the fracture into talar head, neck, body, medial and the posterior surface. So the most common fracture is the talar neck fracture. Then we have the Hawkins classification. Hawkins classification is based on the displacement of the fracture and the displacement of the subtalar or the tibiotalar or the talonavicular joint. So if you see, this is your talus. This is your tibiotalar joint. This is your subtalar joint. Subtalar is below talus. So this is talocalcaneal joint. Subtalar joint is the talocalcaneal joint. And this is your talonavicular joint. This is your navicular bone. So this is your talonavicular joint. So the Hawkins classification is based on the displacement of the fracture. This is your fracture. And the displacement of the three joints, that is tibiotalar, talocalcaneal or the subtalar and the talonavicular joints. So in type 1 Hawkins fracture, there will only be a undisplaced fracture of the talar neck. So there will only be a fracture here towards the talar neck and that will be undisplaced. There will be no displacement of any joints. So in Hawkins type 2, there will be a talar neck fracture which will be displaced and there will be a subtalar dislocation or a subluxation. This is your subtalar joint or the talocalcaneal joint. So, and this is subluxated here. So in type 2 fracture, we have a subtalar dislocation or a subluxation. In type 3 talar neck fracture, there will be a displaced talar neck fracture with dislocation or subluxation of the tibiotalar and the subtalar joints. As you can see here, there is a fracture here. The fracture is displaced. This is your subtalar joint, which is displaced. This is your tibiotalar joint, which is displaced. As you can see, talonavicular joint is not displaced here. So it is type 3. In type 4 fracture, the fracture is displaced and all the three joints are displaced. That is, this is tibiotalar joint, this is subtalar or the talocalcaneal joint, and this is your talonavicular joint. All the three joints are dislocated. So this is the most severe type of injury, that is Hawkins type 4. Then coming to the treatment part, the goals of the treatment are very important. First, we have to do anatomic reduction of the talus neck fractures. Then we have to reduce the dislocated joints. Then we have to have a stable fixation, and we have to try to avoid any complications that may arise due to talus fractures. So in type 1 Hawkins fracture, we can do a non-operative management. We can put a below knee cast. This is your cast, below knee cast. So it's considered for fracture in which there is no displacement of the fracture line and no dislocation of the subtalar joint. It is treated with below knee cast for 6 weeks, after which the patient is asked to walk. In type 2 fractures, in which there is subtalar dislocation and a displaced neck fracture, we can try a conservative management. If we can achieve a close reduction in the operation theater, then we can just put a cast in the operation theater. If on under C-arm images the reduction is not possible, then we can go for a surgical management. As we can see here, screws have been put through the talus neck. In type 3 and type 4 fractures, they cannot be reduced by closed methods. It is very, very difficult and almost 0% chance of reducing closed methods. So we have to open the fracture and we have to surgically fix the fracture. Okay, so here we can see these implants. This here, so we can either use screws, we can either use direct lateral or a medial plate, or we can do external fixation if there is a significant edema. One of the implant that we discussed in the previous lecture was Herbert screw. So the Herbert screw can also be used in talus neck fractures. Then the complications that can occur are avascular necrosis, malunion, a non-union, or a subtalar talotibial or a talonavicular arthritis. So the most common complication is avascular necrosis. Avascular necrosis. This is because 60% of the talus is covered by the articular surface, so there is very limited scope for a blood supply from the proximal to distal direction. So all the blood supplies from the distal to proximal direction. That's why it is more prone to avascular necrosis. Then there is one sign which is known as the Hawkins sign. We had the Hawkins classification before, now we have the Hawkins sign. This is a good sign. If we see subchondral lucency in a talus after a fracture, so I will mark it here. So if you, as you can see the arrow part, we can see that there is subchondral lucency. Lucency means the bone is less dense in this part. So this is a good sign. It is indicative of relative osteopenia secondary to bony resorption and an intact blood supply. It is a good prognostic sign. Its presence indicates less chances of avascular necrosis. Okay. So if this is present, then there are less chances of avascular necrosis. So that finishes our lecture. Thank you very much.